G'day, Chris here, and welcome back to Clickspring. The subject of thin metal tubing in antiquity is interesting to consider because key aspects of the modern conversation around various ancient devices are dependent on just what we believe the artisans of the day were capable of producing. We do have some excellent physical evidence, one of the most spectacular being the Hydrolus of Dion, a predecessor of the modern pipe organ, with various long tubes that Hero of Alexandria tells us were bored on the lathe. Hero's book Pneumatica also suggests something more delicate, with much discussion of long, thin, and occasionally close-fitting metal tubing when describing various mechanism and automata. But it's his clear description of a small piston-driven medical syringe, generally attributed to Ctesibius, that stands out as a solid lead to investigate with respect to the engineering of the Antikythera mechanism. For its part, the mechanism can be reasonably said to have had at least one thin-walled tube as part of its lunar phase display that was likely to have been a running fit on a slender shaft. There's also discussion of the possibility of more complex concentric tubing arrangements to serve the various theoretical models proposed in the research literature. But it's important to note, there's nothing that genuinely qualifies as physical evidence of such thin-walled tubing present in the Antikythera wreckage. So, while we have every reason to accept the idea in theory, a practical demonstration of how such tubing could have been made in antiquity and how it would have performed in practice is necessary to maintain the fidelity of this reconstruction. So, let's have a good look at all of that now. I've made a single starting size drill bit and a set of five reamers, sized to incrementally increase the starting hole in controlled steps to eventually form three close-fitting concentric tubes. As I've shown in a previous video, a proportionally quite deep hole can be drilled and then reamed on the bow lathe, and as it happens, the process scales well for larger holes. Straight off the drill bit, this hole would be good enough in its present state to provide simple clearance, or for a situation requiring a free running fit. But of course, the inside surface of that hole can be much improved by following what we currently have with a simple reamer. Reaming at this size can easily exceed the torque limit of this small lathe, and certainly a larger lathe would be more suitable if continuing to ream on the lathe. Although interestingly, much like the drill bits, once started, the process is self-guiding, and so is easy enough to complete by hand. So at this point, we have a single tube, with an interior surface consistent with a modern reamed finish. As mentioned, three tubes are required for this test, so the others were opened up in the same way. First by using the drill for most of the stock removal, and then by following with the reamers, incrementally working up to the target inside diameter for each tube. Thank you. Okay, so now let's have a look at how well a set of turned pistons can be made to fit inside each of these tubes. The interaction between shaft and cylinder is now approaching a close running fit. There's very little clearance, and the result can be replicated for the other shaft diameters without any change in the process or tools. Naturally, the perimeter features would need to be formed as required, but in terms of the fit, many of the requirements of the ancient automata, for example, will have been met with the processes shown so far. A medical syringe, however, would have benefited from an even closer fit, something that could be depended upon to generate a reliable partial vacuum. For that, it's possible that a very simple addition was made to this already quite straightforward process. To begin with, the shaft could be left in the just filed state without any stoning, to give a light interference fit, something like this. And then the shaft and hole could have been lapped into a sliding fit using an abrasive. As to the identity of that abrasive, there are several possible candidates, such as ash, charcoal, and the many grit-based abrasives of the period. But there is another possibility to consider that could have naturally emerged from how the work was conducted. Jewelers and goldsmiths have a standard practice of collecting the so-called bench sweeps to recover what would otherwise be lost precious metal. Now, while iron wasn't quite so valuable at the time of the mechanism's construction, it was still an energy and labour-intensive resource. So it's easy to imagine the ferrous swarf generated at the bench being saved in a similar way. In particular, if it could be used to generate something useful to the work process, like, for example, a high-performance metal polish. Described in the old horology texts as the red stuff, we know it today more generally as jeweler's rouge. Ignoring the modern organic binders, it's essentially red iron oxide, or rust, in fine particle form. Even today, it remains one of the most effective metal polishing compounds used by the world's jewelers, clock and watchmakers. The abrasive can be applied directly to the metal shaft with some water or olive oil, and immediately felt and heard, generating results, with the most effective approach being to conduct the lapping process on the lathe. The other aspects of the device would of course still need to be formed, but with the addition of lapping to the process, the sliding fit necessary for the function of the medical syringe described by Hero has been achieved. This represents the more demanding end of the range of fits that can reasonably be claimed to have existed within the Antikythera mechanism, leaving only the question of how a set of concentric tubes might have been formed. No doubt there are a few ways this could have been done, but concentric tubes are naturally suited to a common axis of formation. So, if they did indeed exist, perhaps the process went something like this, with the first step being to true up the outside of the surface of the first tube with its internal bore. Assuming a sliding fit is the objective, this outside surface is then lightly filed to a suitable diameter to again give the same light interference fit with the next size up of tubing, and then lapped as required. The process then repeats for the other tubes. For this three-tube test, I set the wall thickness arbitrarily at 0.5 millimetres. That could be reduced to around 0.25 millimetres without much difficulty. So, depending on the starting diameter and the desired wall thickness, it's easy to see how a number of concentric tubes could be formed to operate within a fairly tight space. This tube finishing process is not overly demanding regarding torque, requiring nothing special from either the lathe or bow. If more or longer tubes were required, then all aspects of the lathe could have been scaled up as needed. Now, just before I move on from the red abrasive, I'd like to demonstrate its utility, even in this fairly crude form, as a metal polish on a copper alloy. The many bronze mirrors recovered from the period suggest that a reflective finish was a practical reality. During fabrication, the mirror surface would have been taken through progressively finer filing and abrasive processes on the way to a polished finish. We know little about its earliest use as a polish, but given its solid performance and abundance, perhaps that final polishing step and even the maintenance of the mirror in the home was achieved with nothing more complicated than olive oil and rust. Regardless of its other possible uses, it would have been then, as it is today, a polish that gives an excellent finish on the small lathe. Once formed to the required number and sizes, the tubes can be separated and then cleaned up for examination. Okay, so let's have a look at how the tubes perform. The idea that thin-walled concentric tubing should be a part of the Antikythera mechanism's conjectured planetarium display has been attractive to consider since it was first proposed by independent scholar Michael Wright in 2001. His idea has since been adopted as a critical aspect of many of the models that have followed. Much like for a modern watchmaker, a concern for any maker of this device is the management of the friction throughout the mechanism's gear train and bearings. In particular, the identification of any tendency to bind in the low-torque sections of the train. If such tubing was used in a conjectured planetarium, then it had to have been made to a high standard. Both dry and lubricated, the tubes created for this video move freely and without binding. establishing, in principle at least, that such a system of concentric tubing could plausibly have been created to that high standard using the tools of the period. There'll be much testing and refinement of this process as the build continues. Thanks for watching. I'll see you later.